Growing up, my grandma always told me that the land took care of us, and it still is taking care of us. And it never asked for anything back.
Everything is connected, and it's not humans and animals or humans and the nature around us. You know, we're all connected.
A land acknowledgement is a way to acknowledge that we're coexisting in this land with the native people, and we should acknowledge that this is actually their traditional territory. But at the same time, we are all guests to this land.
The land plays a big factor in who we are. That's what makes us strong. That's what makes us strong people.
All right. Good evening and welcome to tonight's online program, Unraveling the Mysterious Fast Radio Burst with Chime. My name is Hamza Tariq and I'm from the events team at the Central Library. Alongside me is my colleague Kai from the Central Library as well. We also have Simon Poole and Roland Deschain from the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. And along with us, we have our lovely speaker, Dr. Cherry. The Calgary Public Library is thrilled to offer another exciting program in partnership with the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. But before we jump into tonight's program, I would like to share a couple of housekeeping things. At the bottom of your screen, you have an option of Q&A, chat, and raise hand. Please use the chat option if you run into any technical issues, and myself or Kai will be happy to help. The Q&A option can be used to ask your questions related to the talk from Dr. Cherry. You're more than welcome to ask a question during the program or save it until the end for our Q&A, which will be moderated by Simon. You can also raise hand option, or you can also use the raise hand option during the Q&A, and Simon will unmute you to ask your question live. During the talk, please keep your audio turned off to avoid any distractions to the presenter. Now, I would like to pass it over to Roland to speak on behalf of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. Roland?
I'm Roland Deschain. I am Royal Canada. Right after this meeting, for members only, we are seeing the changeover of the guard, you might say, where at our annual general meeting for members only, Simon Poole, my co-host tonight, will become our center president for the next 2 years. It's been a fun run for 2 years. I love doing outreach. This year has been a kind of a challenge doing outreach, but we did have an opportunity with our friends over at the Cross Conservation Area to do outside star walks, socially distanced. And this is a photo from one of those evenings there. It was a night of great beauty and some amount of coldness. But we had the second full moon of October, and by the modern definition, that the second full moon in a month is the blue moon. So here's a frigid cold blue moon image. We had ice crystals in the atmosphere, and so we got to see some beautiful lunar halo effects around that moon, again from the Cross Conservation Area. So I'm going to run through the agenda quickly. Welcome everybody. Thank you for coming to our final public lecture of the season. Our last general meeting, as we like to call it, with the Calgary Center of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada. I've got a few slides to talk about our organization, and then I'm gonna run through some upcoming events and activities. And then, finally, Dr. Cherry Ng, who will be speaking on the topic of unraveling the mysterious fast radio burst with CHIME. About the RASC, you can read the screen. I will try not to read it, but we do have some wonderful equipment and facilities at our club observatory for use by members. We have a lot of different things you get for your membership. We've got rental scopes and a dark site for camping. And we do lots of stuff like that. And I encourage you that if you want any more information about this, either go right to our website, calgary.rasc.ca, or the more general astronomycalgary.com, where you can hook up with TELUS-SPARC and the Rothney Astrophysical Observatory as well from that site. But we've got lots of different ways you can track us on the web, Facebook, Twitter, our meetup group, and YouTube. So, speeding along here. Later on tonight, for members only, we need your membership number starting at 8:15. This is our elections, new bylaw amendments, and an excellent talk by Tom Evans about the Reese Impact Crater. This Friday, we've got another one of the outstandingly successful Chasing Dark Skies virtual astronomy event. This is where the Rothney Astrophysical Observatory of the University of Calgary is basically broadcasting the sky through their telescopes with a nonstop companion of information delivered by Dr. Phil Langille, the director of the observatory. It was great fun the last time they did it. So tomorrow night, watch for that, 7 to 10. Go to their website or that astronomycalgary.com website to find a link to that. On this Saturday, I'll be speaking about purchasing astronomy equipment for your youth. That is another event co-hosted by our good friends with the Calgary Public Library. It's an online seminar on Saturday afternoon. Go to the Calgary Public Library website for events and basically search for astronomy, and you'll be able to find the registration link for that event. We've got another full moon at the end of this month, and unlike last month, this one passes partially through the Earth's shadow. Not super convenient timing for those of us who've got a day job, but basically in the wee hours of Monday morning, so Sunday night, set an alarm, and what you'll see is a slightly dimmer gray moon. The moon will be passing through the outer part of the Earth's shadow, and the darker part, the umbra, the moon never gets into it. And that's when we really see the darkness on the face of the moon. And if the moon's totally within the umbra, we get to see those strikingly bright orange or brown, dark brown colors on the moon. But the moon will be slightly darker along part of its side and fully outside the atmosphere, the shadow on the other side. So that's Monday the 30th. Put that on your calendar and then set your alarm to get a look out. Mid eclipse is about 2:45 in the morning. Into December then, we have a youth group meeting at again online because of COVID, of course. Our good friend and member Don Holadiak, who is now been elected or will be inducted as a fellow of the Royal Geographic Society of Canada. Congrats, Don. He'll have his standard morning radio piece on CBC Radio 1. So that's 10:10 a.m. or 99.1 FM. For our council, be the first meeting of our new council. Again, an online meeting on Thursday the 10th. Our new Observers to Visual Astronomy event for our beginning members is on Friday the 11th, another online meeting. Following day, Saturday the 12th, Observers Group meeting, and that's also an online meeting. Finally, I will be doing a talk about the Christmas star as an astronomical phenomenon, taking clues from the Bible texts and trying to decipher what people might have seen in the night sky if that was a actual astronomical phenomenon. This is also presented in partnership with the Calgary Public Library, and you can go to their website to find that event and many other ones from other organizations, but sign up for that. That is Monday, December 14th, 7 p.m. And I want the table. I'll let it. I'm pretty proud of that dynamic graphic. And then, kind of long time in the future, in the new year, our next meeting, such as the one that we're having tonight, will feature Serafina Nance, PhD student, Department of Astronomy at University of California, Berkeley. And she'll be talking about supernovae and their applications to cosmology. So put that on your long range calendar, perhaps, you know, your new calendar that when you hang it up on the wall for next year. Finally, and the reason we're having our meeting tonight, Dr. Cherry Ng, Unraveling the Mysterious Fast Radio Bursts with CHIME, and CHIME stands for the Canadian Hydrogen Intensity Mapping Experiment, a radio telescope project. She received her PhD from the Max Planck Institute of Radio Astronomy in Germany, was a postdoc at the University of British Columbia. She joined the Dunlop Institute in September 2017. Her research interests lie in the area of pulsars and transients, as well as signal processing algorithms for telescope instrumentation. And she has discovered 60 pulsars as of the time of this writing, 2.5% of all known population at the time with the Parkes Radio Telescope in Australia. And so I'm going to pass this back on to Hamza to talk a bit more about the meeting procedures, and then we'll have our feature speaker.
Thank you, Roland. All right, for everyone who just joined us, I would take this opportunity to share the Zoom housekeeping again. But before I do that, I will be launching a poll, which we encourage everyone to participate in. The poll will stay on for about a minute. You'll be seeing the poll on your screen in about 3 seconds. All right, thank you everyone for participating. Now I'll do a quick recap of housekeeping things again. At the bottom of your screen, you have an option of Q&A, chat, and raise hand. Please use the chat option if you run into any technical issues, and myself or Kai will be happy to help. The Q&A option can be used to ask questions related to the talk from Dr. Cherry. You're more than welcome to ask a question during the program or save it until the end of the talk for our Q&A, which will be moderated by Simon. You can also use the raise hand option during our Q&A at the end, and Simon will unmute you to ask your question live. Now, during the talk, please keep your audio turned off to avoid any distractions to Cherry. And now, without any further delay, I would like to pass it over to Cherry.
Hi, everybody. So I'm going to share my screen and start the slideshow. Is it working for you?
Looks good.
Yep.
Okay, great. All right, so let's go right in to start my talk. Yes, here. All right, so when it comes to doing astronomy on Earth, there are only two windows of the electromagnetic spectrum where radiation can pass through the Earth's atmosphere to reach us. Now, the most easily accessible one is surely the visible light. I think everybody has at some point looked up at the night sky with your eyes, or perhaps you have had the opportunity to look through an optical telescope at an observatory or in the backyard. Now, the perhaps less known window is radio astronomy, and that's what we are going to talk about tonight. You might have seen some radio telescopes already. Maybe it is the Arecibo telescope in James Bond's Golden Eye, or maybe it is the very large array in the film Contact. Now, speaking of which, this morning we have heard the devastating news of the decommissioning of the Arecibo telescope due to an irreparable damage caused by a cable failure that happened earlier on. Now, this is a really sad day for the astronomy community, and I would like to pay a little tribute to the great science Arecibo has given us. Okay, back to the topic of radio astronomy. If we look in Canada, we also have a world-class radio telescope that has been producing groundbreaking astronomy discoveries. And this is the CHIME radio telescope and what I would like to talk to you about tonight. The story of how CHIME helps to unravel the mystery of fast radio burst. CHIME is located in British Columbia at the Dominion Radio Astrophysical Observatory. It is a primarily Canadian research experiment involving the University of British Columbia, McGill University, Perimeter Institute, and the University of Toronto, where I am from. This is a time-lapse video with CHIME in sight. Day and night, CHIME scans the universe as the sky drifts overhead. Now, one night, CHIME saw something unexpected, a mysterious burst in radio waves. Astronomers have named these bursts fast radio bursts, or FRB. Fast because these bursts apparently only last for a fraction of a second. We don't know much about these bursts. They seem to happen at unpredictable time and location. We don't know where they come from. And the only thing we can tell is that they appear to have traveled from much further than the Milky Way galaxy. They're extragalactic. Now you might wonder, how do we tell the distance of this burst? Indeed, it is a pretty tricky thing to find out distance of a star in astronomy. And tonight I would like to share with you a cool trick, something called the dispersion. Here is an artist's impression of what an FRB might look like. Fast radio burst has a range of energy. If we use color to illustrate the purpose, blue for highest energy waves, yellow for medium energy, and red for the lowest energy waves. As the fast radio burst travels through cosmos to reach us on Earth, it has to go through the interstellar medium, which is not a vacuum. It consists of dust and gas. Now these dust and gas slow down the waves as the burst comes to us. And it affects the low energy red waves more than anything else. As a result, what we see on Earth is that the burst becomes dispersed. The high energy waves come to us faster, and the low energy, the red waves, arrives with a time lag. So the waves, the burst is spread out. The more spread out the wave is, the longer distance it must have traveled through. It is from this huge amount of dispersion that we realize fast radio bursts must have come from extragalactic distances outside of our Milky Way. This is the plot of the very first fast radio burst ever detected. The thick black line is the FRB signal. Using the same color analogy, you can see how the blue waves arrive at an earlier time compared to the red low energy waves. Now these plots are relevant here because we use them like profile pictures for fast radio burst. They are like headshots. We can use these headshots to learn about and characterize each fast radio burst and see how they differ from each other. Now you have some idea of how to interpret these plots. Keep it in mind because it will become useful later on in the talk. The fast radio burst phenomenon has attracted a lot of attention in the media. The Washington Post has called it the most mysterious signal in space, and some wonder if it could be aliens. So back to the start, how is CHIME going to help solve the FRB mystery? The first reason is that CHIME is really big. It covers an area of 80 meters by 100 meters. Or in Canadian units, the equivalent of 5 hockey arenas together. It is so big, and that means we can collect as much information as possible, maximizing our sensitivity. Here is a cross-section of how one of the cylinders looked like and two hockey players for size comparison. The way it works is that radio waves are reflected off the parabolic cylinder surface, and they are concentrated to the focal point where we put our detectors. Now, this unconventional cylinder shape of the CHIME radio telescope is the second reason why it has been such a game changer in the study of fast radio bursts. To explain this better, I'll have to take a step back and let's take a look at how a more traditional radio telescope looks like. This one here is the Parkes radio telescope, the one I did my PhD study on. Parkes was built in the 60s and is a real classic. In fact, it is also affectionately known as the dish because of the dish shape. If you haven't seen it already, there is an awesome movie with the same title, The Dish, that documents the story of the Parkes radio telescope. So go check it out if you haven't seen this movie. Now back to the dish. The dish is really good at focusing at one point in the sky. However, when it comes to the study of fast radio bursts, as we said, they are unpredictable. We don't know when they go off and where they go off. So if you're only staring at a tiny spot on the sky, the chance of catching an FRB goes off is really small. CHIME, on the other hand, has this revolutionary design of a cylinder shape, and it means that CHIME can see a very different view. It scans a much larger area of the sky at any given time, as represented by this green rectangle. If we compare the two views side by side, the small circle is from the traditional radio telescope and the large rectangle from CHIME. And it's obvious that the view of CHIME is way bigger. Now, as the sky drifts overhead, CHIME has a much better chance of detecting an FRB as it bursts. The third reason why CHIME is such a powerful instrument is because of its sensitivity. Here I am holding in my hand one of the detectors we have designed to collect radio waves. We came up with a cool idea. Now, instead of having just one detector, what if we have 1,000 of them and we put them all on CHIME? If we are able to digitally combine the signal from each of these detectors, we'll be multiplying the strength of our signal by many folds, maximizing the sensitivity. Only that there is a problem here. With so many components, we'll have a huge data rate, exactly 13 terabits per second. Now, this number doesn't mean anything, right? What if I tell you that's the equivalent of the entire cell phone network in North America put together and that we'll have to process in any given time? We'll need some pretty high performance computer to keep up with this data rate. And that's exactly the expertise of the long wavelength lab where I work at the University of Toronto. This photo shows a daily scene in our lab, well, pre-COVID at least, where we worked there designing hardware, coding software, and optimizing algorithms. We care about pushing the boundaries of technology in order to expand the horizon of knowledge and to make groundbreaking discoveries of astronomy. It was a tremendous effort to build this supercomputer from scratch by ourselves. You can see here some photos of our students building computers on site at CHIME. When we reached the milestone of having installed 246 computers, we made a cake to celebrate this occasion. I say it's a pretty good cake. Now, I've been with the CHIME team for over 5 years now, and I'm really proud of this telescope. Each little piece has been built by students and researchers like me. In the middle is a photo of me working on site at CHIME. I was plugging in cables. We have over 2,000 cables. Each of them need to be correctly labeled and plug in at the right place. It was a really tedious job. And the construction of CHIME, all in all, took over 3 years. And we finally obtained first light in 2018. Obviously, another great milestone deserved a more elaborated cake for the celebration. Since CHIME has begun operation, it has been a real game changer in the study of fast radio bursts. In this chart here, I'm showing the number of fast radio bursts discovered as a function of year. I've used different color to represent different radio telescope facilities. the chime count is shown by the red bar, and you can see that chime is the clear winner here. In fact, in just the first 2 months of operation, chime has detected 13 fast radio bursts, an order of magnitude more than any other radio telescope facilities. I led my team to publish this exciting result in the high-profile scientific journal called Nature, and they were so impressed by our work that they've put us on the cover page. If we were to fast forward this till the end of 2019, this is how it looks. CHIME is rapidly building up a population census of fast radio bursts. With such a large number of fast radio bursts detected, we are slowly piecing together important clues that might tell us what FRBs are. One of the highlight discoveries CHIME has found is that some FRB repeats. While the majority of these fast radio bursts seems to be one-off events, they burst and never again, CHIME has detected that 18 fast radio bursts bursted again from the same sky location over multiple days. Most of this repetition seems to be random. However, two fast radio bursts have shown some periodic cycle of activity. One of the fast radio bursts has been monitored by telescopes around the world. The Arecibo telescope, well before the cable failure, has worked with the European Very Long Baseline Interferometer, the VLBI network, and together they have triangulated and pinpointed the location of one of these fast radio bursts. And it turns out that this fast radio burst came from an older dwarf galaxy that is 3 billion light years away from Earth. And just very recently, a few weeks ago, CHIME has detected, together with the Algonquin Radio Telescope in Ontario, they've detected another fast radio burst, only that this burst is like 1,000 times brighter than any other burst CHIME has seen. Now, it turns out the reason why it's so bright is because this fast radio burst is really close to us. It's within our Milky Way this time. And it turns out that this fast radio burst came from a highly magnetized neutron star, or also known as magnetar. Now, theories are quick to suggest that perhaps on this magnetar, scaled up, dramatic scale up version of solar flare, like what happens on our sun when it releases huge amount of magnetic energy, and just like what is shown in this artistic impression here, perhaps this kind of energetic event is what has produced the bright fast radio bursts that we have seen. You might wonder, so is this the end of the FRB detective? So have we figured everything out? Not quite. We have perhaps pinpointed the origin of one fast radio burst, this one from the magnetar. And in fact, by now, a handful of other fast radio bursts, we have been able to localize to from which galaxy they came from. We don't know exactly whereabouts in those galaxies, but at least we know the type of the galaxy. What we notice is that the few FRBs that have been localized, they came from very different galaxy environment. Some of those were from old dwarf galaxy, like the previous one I mentioned, but some other are from young star-forming regions of the galaxy. And let's not forget the fact that some FRBs repeats while some not. It is very likely that there are more than one class of fast radio bursts and perhaps multiple astrophysical processes that can produce this bright burst that we are seeing. We really need more data to be really sure what are these fast radio bursts. And this is where you could help. If you're stuck at home because of the pandemic and interested, there is this Burst from Space project on the Zooniverse platform. The Zooniverse platform is a people-powered research platform where volunteers can help contribute to outstanding science questions, just like fast radio burst. In CHIME, for example, one of our bottlenecks is that we have so much data. We could really do with some help to classify the signal that we are detecting. Are they real fast radio bursts, or are they just noise, or could it be artificially generated interference? Now that you have listened to my talk and know all about fast radio bursts, you are the perfect volunteers for the Zooniverse project. Birth from Space has launched only a few weeks ago and has already registered over 300 volunteers. And together they have contributed over 33,000 signals classification of CHIME data. That's really impressive what we can achieve when we work together as a community. I think we are really close to solve the mystery of fast radio bursts. Soon we'll be able to know what are the objects behind these energetic bursts that appears to come from extragalactic distances. Could they be supermassive black holes or energetic events like merging of neutron stars, asteroid collision, or maybe catastrophe like collapse of a neutron star? Or are they all like the one we just talked about from very magnetized neutron star magnetars? Time will tell, and for now, I'm really excited to be working in this forefront research of fast radio bursts, and stay tuned. I hope that next time I'll be able to share with you more groundbreaking results from our team. Thank you.
Great. Thank you so much for that very interesting talk. That was amazing. We'll move on to the question and answer period now. If anybody has any questions, you're more than welcome to type them into the Q&A slot, and we'll talk about them. You're also more than welcome to raise your hand, and I'll unmute you, and you can ask your question live. So we've got a few questions, and the first one is, how will you distinguish between these hypotheses?
Yeah, great question. That's also what we are wondering, right? One way is clear answer would be if we can tell exactly, if we can pinpoint exactly which star it comes from. For example, the very last case that I mentioned, we found out that it came from magnetar. Okay, so magnetar is the answer for that fast radio burst, for example. If we see more of these, then we can start to say, okay, some theory works, some not. We can also approach it from the entire population point of view. So for example, if we detect X number of fast radio bursts, then we can say that, okay, this event rate is compatible with certain stellar objects. So then it must be black holes, or it must be neutron stars, things like that.
Awesome, that's great. We have another question, and it asks, what does the future of radio astronomy look like? What is the leading theory to what these bursts are?
The future of radio astronomy? Yeah. So for a long time now, the trend in radio astronomy has been to build big dishes, bigger and bigger dishes, because they are more and more sensitive. But as I mentioned, there are downsides to big dishes as well, because they can only look at one spot in the sky. They tend to be also expensive and hard to maintain. And as I also alluded to, the very sad story of the damage on Arecibo, it's just irreparable for that same reason. So I see that the trend in radio astronomy is going to smaller dishes that we can combine them to get back to make up for the sensitivity of, for example, things like CHIME. And a lot of the radio astronomy has definitely gone to the technicals, a lot of the radio astronomy advancement has been driven by technology as well. Better computers, for example, enable us to handle higher and higher data volume. So this is where I see the field is going. The second part of the question was about the theories.
Yeah, what is the leading theory as to what the fast radio bursts are?
Yeah, I think the leading theory is indeed the magnetar, because it was already the leading theory before this very recent discovery, where we actually saw the FRB from magnetar. So this one is the leading one. Although there are also some other evidence, like I said, that with other FRBs have been located at a diverse environment, and some of them look like they are incompatible with having come from a magnetar as well. So we don't know yet, but we know that at least Magnetar has made one fast radio burst.
That's awesome.
Simon, can I interrupt?
Yes.
We got some questions showing up in chat.
Yeah, I'm looking at that too.
Okay, so you're aware of those then? All right.
Yeah, I'll go through both in time, no worry. Okay. We've got a question. Do you find it frustrating that the media automatically assumes alien life with fast radio bursts in their headlines?
Yeah, I suppose. I think it is pretty clear from our data that fast radio burst is not from aliens, but it tends to be what the media picks up.
Cool. And the question is back to the magnetars. So why is a magnetar the leading explanation?
Right. One reason is that we did detect one, so that's an easy answer. But apart from that, the fact that fast radio bursts are so short in duration, as I mentioned, only a fraction of a second, right? So the short duration indicates that whatever has generated these bursts has to be a really, really compact object. So it's probably not something like our sun, for example. It has to be small, like a neutron star or like a black hole. And then it must be really energetic because these bursts are really bright. And the fact that they come from such a large distance, it must have been super bright where it came from for the fact that we can see them. So it has to be something energetic as well. And so that's two of the main reasons why magnetar is a good candidate.
That's great. We've got lots of questions. We'll try to get to them all. We have a question. I heard in a talk a year ago in which it was suggested that Dickey's super radiance might explain fast radio bursts. What do you think of this?
Wow, I see we have some well-informed audience here. I'm not very familiar with that theory.
How many fast radio bursts, can you estimate how many fast radio bursts hit the Earth every day?
I think the current estimation is that there are some thousand bursts happening per sky per day.
Wow, that's a lot. So we have another question. How strong or weak is the signal strength when compared to other radio sources in space? Also, which of the frequency spectrum do fast radio bursts originate in?
Right. So, So in fact, fast radio bursts are pretty weak as seen from the telescope. They were super bright where they were generated, but they have traveled through this massive distances, right? So by the time it hits us on Earth at the telescope, it's really, really weak. In fact, some of the typical issues that we have at the telescope is artificial interference. Things like mobile phone. If you switch on your mobile phone next to the telescope, it would have completely drowned any astronomical signal. Yeah, so very weak. And then, what's the next thing again?
Sorry, which of the frequency spectrum fast radio bursts originate in?
Yeah, right. So fast radio bursts has now been detected in the radio spectrum, but not the entire radio spectrum still. We are seeing it in a certain window within the radio band. It goes up to a few gigahertz down to 3 megahertz or so.
Wow, that's great. Somebody asks, are the bursts affected or contaminated by satellites orbiting the Earth?
Yeah, so satellites is another interference that nuisance for observations, they are much brighter than astronomy signal as well. So yeah, and we do see satellites and GPS and LTE band, things like that.
Great.
This is also a reason why CHIME is located at the Dominion Radio Astrophysical Observatory, because it is a protected site, a national protected site, radio quiet zone. So already from there, we get better data, but yeah, there are still things like satellites, which, you know, you see it from everywhere. Yeah, the Starlink is terrible for us, that you can't hide from it.
Yeah, for sure. And I know that's terrible for astro imagers as well. Mm-hmm. We've got a question from Larry. He's got a couple of questions. Does CHIME record all day, every day?
Yes, CHIME records all day, every day. Well, yeah, pretty much. Radio astronomy is not so much affected by weather, so to say. Rain, cloud, even snow we can handle if it's not too much snow. And we also can observe day and night. During the daytime, the data is a little worse because the sun is in fact also a strong radio source. For the search of fast radio bursts, we can still manage with the daytime data. So we run as much as we can.
Cool. Does it detect polarization of the radio signal?
Yes, it does. We have a pretty sophisticated data analysis scheme. So when we observe the data, when we observe the sky, we analyze them. We are searching for this dispersed signal, and when we the mechanism is that when we detect something interesting, we are able to ask the telescope to save a tiny bit of the original data, not to throw it away yet. So save the original data, and then we can do further more detailed analysis. One of which is the polarization study of this burst. In fact, polarization is really important here because it's one of the things that can tell us about the magnetic field of the burst.
That's awesome. What inspired you to study fast radio bursts?
Right, so yeah. My background is in fact in pulsar astronomy. As Roland has mentioned in the introduction, I found 60 pulsars in my PhD study. So pulsars are these rapidly spinning neutron stars. And so I was searching for pulsars in my PhD work, but it was around this time when fast radio bursts started to become a thing. The first fast radio burst was noticed in 2001, but there was only one burst back then, and people were really skeptical about it. They thought that, oh, maybe it was just a fluke, or maybe it was interference. Nobody took it seriously. It wasn't only until 2013, I think, my team on the Parkes radio telescope, we found four other fast radio bursts, and then people really thought, okay, this is a new phenomenon here. We should look into it. And that's how I got into the study of fast radio burst.
Wow, that's great. So we'll do one more from the question and answer, then I'll start going through the chat. We have a question. Why do the longer wavelengths travel more slowly through dust clouds?
Right. Yeah, I don't want to go into too much technical details here. But the dust and gas, they are scattering the waves, and also because of how the free electron interacts with the wave, so it's the lower energy waves get slowed down more.
Okay, that's
and in great. Fact, the amount of slowdown is entirely predictable. We can calculate the amount as a function of the energy of the waves. And that is why fast radio bursts has been so easy to find, in fact, because we were able to see this exact dispersion that we can expect.
Perfect. I heard you mention this a few questions ago, but do you get much snow on the telescope? But I guess it doesn't matter too much, is what you were saying.
Yeah, it's mostly okay. So the CHIME cylinder, in fact, is designed as a mesh. So it's about like 2 centimeter mesh. And most of this, when it's light snow, it can go through. And so it's fine. And even when it's a bit of snow sticking on the surface, it's all right. But when it's too much, yeah, indeed, it's like if it's too much snow, in fact, it's a lot of weight on the surface, right? So it's slightly deforming it, and that's affecting our data quality as well.
Okay. Somebody asks, do you have enough samples to estimate the frequency distribution of distances from Earth of those events?
We have now detected a couple hundred fast radio bursts. I can't give away too much detail here because we are still working on the analysis, but yeah, we are seeing that fast radio bursts it seems to come, there is no preferred location in the sky.
Okay. What do fast radio bursts tell us about the interstellar medium?
Interesting. Fast radio bursts, actually it doesn't, I would say it doesn't tell us a lot about the interstellar medium, but it tells us a lot, it could tell us a lot about the intergalactic medium. Now, because the interstellar medium, which is typically what we refer to as in within our Milky Way galaxy, it consists of this dust and gas and free electrons, and we know it pretty well because there has been a lot of, you know, like pulsars and things like that. So, and we can model the behavior pretty well. Now, one of the reasons why FRB has generated so much attention is because, not only because of the mysteriousness of it, but also because fast radio bursts might have a huge science potential. The fact that it comes from such a large distance, it has gone through the intergalactic medium as well. So between our Milky Way galaxy and the galaxy where the fast radio burst came from, the huge distance, this huge space between, which honestly we don't know much about because there has been very few things that are so bright that can be used as like a probe to study the intergalactic medium. So we are hoping that fast radio bursts, by the time we have found like tens of thousands of them, we might be able to use them to map the intergalactic medium to tell us something about what is the composition of the intergalactic medium, for example.
That is really fascinating. Wow. What else does CHIME do other than look for fast radio bursts?
Yeah, great question. So in fact, CHIME was originally is designed to study fast radio bursts. Originally, it is meant to be a cosmology experiment. As the name suggests, it's an experiment to map neutral hydrogen. The original goal here is to create a 3D map of the hydrogen, and by studying the expansion of hydrogen, we want to tell the expansion history of universe. That's the original goal, and that is still one of our main science goal here. It's just that the cosmology experiment requires a high level of precision, and We estimate that we need to collect at least 5 years of data to be able to really say something about it. So we are still working on it. So apart from cosmology and fast radio bursts, CHIME is also really powerful instrument to study pulsars, these rapidly spinning neutron stars. And we have been monitoring known pulsars, and we have also detected some new ones that nobody has seen before. Yeah, lots of spin-off science that we didn't expect we could do with CHIME.
That's really cool. The shape of the CHIME Observatory is revolutionary compared to past radio telescopes. Who came up with that idea?
Oh, okay. That's before my time. Not sure exactly who. Now, it is... So there has been other cylinder radio telescope out there. So CHIME is not exactly the only one. There is one in Australia where it is cylinder like that as well, but it has got two cross arms instead of four side by side. And then there is another one, I think, in France that kind of it's kind of like a one cylinder on the ground as well. I think there might be another cross-like one in Italy. But those ones were from many years ago. And so even though there was the idea to build a cylinder back then, there was not the technology to support it. So like I mentioned, the cylinder shape is one thing, but the other thing is that we managed to put so many detectors on the surface in order to really take advantage of this huge area. So back then, even though people had thought about using cylinder, they were not able to keep up with this high data rate of having so many components. So I think there were multiple reasons that made CHIME so successful.
That's cool. Somebody asks, can you point the scope about the sky in any given point in time, or is it pretty much solid and the sky points to it?
Right. So the telescope itself cannot move. The hardware, there's no moving part. It just looks up direct, straight up sky. But we, having said that, we are still able to point the telescope using software. So we could, by phasing up different components with calculated time lag, we can effectively sort of maximize our sensitivity to a certain direction within the direct overhead where CHIME can see. So if you remember, I've shown this huge rectangle where CHIME has sensitivity to. So that's what we can see in any given time, but we can still sort of direct our sensitivity to a certain point within the rectangle. And in fact, this is what we do for the search of fast radio bursts. We effectively create 1,000 sub beams within the large rectangles. So sublocations within the rectangle. So, and then we are looking in each of them separately. So when we detect an FRB, we know already where it came from. Because if you didn't do that, so you have this huge rectangle, you detect an FRB, that's great, but you don't know where exactly in the rectangle it came from. So that doesn't help too, because the rectangle is so huge.
That's great. We got a few more questions. The CHIME telescope surrounded by mountains, does that help with reducing the radio interference?
Yeah, it does help a little bit. Yeah, it does help. The mountain protects it from some of the interference, but it also meant that we don't quite see down to the horizon. So our sight is a little limited by the mountain towards the horizon.
Okay. How does the high bandwidth of data get transferred from CHIME to the analyzing system around the world?
Yeah, we can't. And that is why we built this computer cluster right there, right next to the telescope. the data rate is just too high. We have to deal with it right then. And in fact, we have to, as mentioned, this sophisticated analysis scheme, we have to do everything real time. So we have to look into the data. We have to see, is there anything interesting? If there's nothing interesting, we throw it away. We just can't afford to keep all this this huge data rate. So that's also why we have to be very clever with our algorithm, because if you missed it, you're throwing it away and then it's lost. So we have to analyze it right there. And only for the candidate fast radio bursts, so like the gold-plated candidates, so we save the original data, and that we are able to then send it back to the to each institute for further analysis.
That's cool. So we've got time for one more question, and it's asked, given the distances you are implying, do lensing effects come into play in the statistical interpretation of the data that you are looking to evaluate?
Yeah, that's a PhD right there. Some of us are thinking about that, so I don't have the answer yet.
Cool. Well, that's all the time we have for questions. On behalf of the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada, I'd like to thank you for joining us here this evening. That was a very inspiring, amazing talk, and I'm very excited to learn more about your research and through any articles that will come my way, I'm going to be able to hopefully somewhat more understand it as I read it. So thank you very much. I'll turn it over to Roland and Hamza to close this out, but thank you very much.
Thank you for having me.
It was an excellent talk. Thank you for taking the time tonight. And that also goes for all our guests from across the country and the US. And remember, we've got upcoming programming with the Calgary Public Library this Saturday for Buying a Telescope for Your Youth, and December 14th for the Christmas Star presentation. And to take us out this evening, Hamza from the Calgary Public Library.
All right. Thank you, Roland. Thank you so much, everyone. On behalf of the Calgary Library, I would like to thank all the participants for spending their evening with us today. I want to apologize for the comment that was passed on in the chat earlier, but I do appreciate everyone's patience. I also want to thank Simon, Roland, and the Royal Astronomical Society of Canada for another wonderful program. The library really values this partnership, and we're looking forward to the program on December 14th and the ones in 2021. Also, Cherry, thank you so much for taking the time out to do the talk and share your knowledge and experience with us. It has been a treat. Thank you once again, everyone, and see you all next time.